Our last speaker of the morning session is Maria Nowak, and she's going to talk about kernels of Toeplitz operators and the Branges-Rovnyak spaces. Please, Maria.
Thank you very much. Thank you for giving me opportunity to talk here, to have a lecture. Good morning, everyone, or good afternoon, or good evening, even maybe. So this talk is based, let me first say, on joint work with my colleagues from my university, UMCS, Maria Curie-Skłodowska University, and with one colleague from Poznań, Adam Mickiewicz University. So I start with Kernel Toeplitz, with kernels of Toeplitz operators, and next continue with the Branges-Rovnyak spaces and show relations between these two notions and items. Okay, so I will use actually similar notation to that used by Dan Timothy in his lecture, in his mini course. So H2 is the standard Hardy space on the unit disk, which can be also considered as a subspace of L2 on the boundary of unit disk on T. I will denote by T the boundary of unit disk. And for phi in L infinity on T, the Toeplitz operator with symbol phi on H2 is given by the formula T phi f is just P plus of phi f, whereby P plus is the orthogonal projection of L2 onto H2. I think that these three properties of Toeplitz operators are the most important, are crucial, and they allow us to derive from many properties, many other further properties of Toeplitz operators. So the norm of T phi is just the norm in L infinity of phi, and T phi adjoint is T phi bar. And especially third one is very important and very often used. I will use it in a moment. If phi and psi are in L infinity and at least one of them is in H, is analytic, is H infinity, then we have such a equality, T psi bar, T phi is the same as operator T with symbol psi bar phi. And these properties of Toeplitz operators imply actually that if M is the kernel of T phi, then the exist and outer function F in H2 and an inner function I such that I of zero is zero, and such that this M is also the kernel of T with symbol I bar F bar over F. And actually, it's quite easy to, so let me show this fact. This also show how we can use this third property of Toeplitz operator. So first I show that if I have a function from H2 in the kernel of T phi, and this function has I always can be written as product of inner function and F naught, which is outer function in H2. And what we want to show first is that if F is in the kernel of T phi, then its outer factor also is in the kernel of T phi. So we have, and to see this, it's enough to know that T phi F naught is the same as, because on the boundary when U is inner function u bar u is one just, so we have d phi u bar u f naught, which is using this property I mentioned before, is the same as d phi u bar u f naught. And again, this property is the same as t u bar t phi f, and by assumption, this is zero, which shows that f naught is in the kernel, also if f is in the kernel. And to continue this, assume that we have function f, which is in the kernel of t phi, then we can write that then we have that phi f is equal ig conjugated, where I is inner function vanishing at zero and g is an outer function, because this is just these functions are conjugated functions from H2 that vanishes at zero. From this equality, one can get that, one can see that in this case, phi can be calculated. Phi is I bar g bar over f, and by assumption, phi is in L infinity. And this actually shows also that because g and f is, both of them are outer functions, this function is a function from L, h infinity, which is outer. And in this case, t with symbol outer function or conjugated outer function has trivial kernel, so we can put here t phi is the same as t I g bar over f, and multiply and divide by f bar, and we get such inequality. And since the kernel of t with symbol g bar over f bar is trivial, this recall that this is outer conjugation of outer function, this kernel is trivial, so we indeed have equality that kernel phi is equal I f bar over f. Always we can find such inner function and such outer function that we have. Now, let S denote, as usual, the unilateral shift on H2. As Dan Timothy mentioned, S star is a joint operator, which is T with symbol Z bar, and can be, and for S star, we have this formula, S star F is F of Z minus F of 0 over Z. And now we have the next definition. This is definition of merely star invariant subspace. Closed subspace M of H2 is said to be merely a star invariant if such an implication is satisfactory, holds. If F is in M and F of zero is zero, then S star F is in M again. Very important property of Toeplitz operator is that they are star, merely star invariant subspaces of H2. Indeed, if I have function that vanishes at zero, then I can write that F is equal to Z F1, and suppose that F is in the kernel of phi, then I need to show that F1 is also in the kernel T phi. So similarly, as above, I get T phi of F1 is the same as T Z bar Z phi F1. And again, this is the same as T Z bar T phi ZF is the same as T Z bar T phi of F is zero, which means that T phi of F1 is zero. So this shows that that kernels of Toeplitz operators are merely a star invariant subspaces of H2. nearly S-star invariant subspaces were characterized by heat in 1988. And here I cite this, his theorem. A closed subspace M of H2 is nearly a star invariant if and only if there exists a function f of unit norm with normalization, say f of 0 greater than 0, and a model space Ki, which is the orthogonal complement of IH2. So I is, of course, inner function such that M is equal to F multiplied by Ki, where I is an inner function vanishing at the origin. And what is important, the operator of multiplication by F is isometric operator from Ki into H2. However, not every, so we know that every kernel of a Toeplitz operator is a star invariant subspace of H2. However, the converse is not true. Not every star invariant space is the kernel of a Toeplitz operator. The S star invariant subspaces that are kernels of Toeplitz operators were characterized by Eric Hayashi in 1980. And to state his results, we need a notion of a rigid function in H1. A function H in H1 is called rigid if and only if no other function in H1 except for positive scalar multiples of itself, so C times F, have the same argument as F almost everywhere on T. And I mentioned only one remark connected with this definition that every rigid function in H1 must be an outer function. Indeed, it's easy to see if we have inner functions, say omega, so this omega is on the boundary value, can be written like e to power I psi of t. And then we have, on one hand, 1 plus omega squared is certainly not constant times omega. And on the other hand, argument 1 plus omega squared is equal to argument omega almost everywhere. So f must be an outer function if f is rigid, is a rigid function. So I need further notational conventions to state these results of Hayashi. Assume that f is an outer function of unit norm in H2 with normalization f of 0 greater than 0. And we know that f can be written in the form f is equal to a over 1 minus b, where b and a are functions from the unit ball of H infinity. And b, and actually a is the outer function. And on the boundary, they satisfy such equality. A squared modulus plus modulus b squared is 1 almost everywhere. How to get such a representation of outer and the outer function with such that of modulus of unit norm such that f of 0 is greater than 0? So one can start with Herplot's integral of function modulus f on the boundary. And one get function capital F of Z, which is function which has a positive real part. So in this case, F has positive real part in the unit, this capital S F can be written in the form 1 plus V over 1 minus V, where V is the unit ball of H infinity. And in this way, we can get function V. Next, we can define function A as F. A here is A is F over 1 minus B, so F is A over 1 minus B equivalently. And of course, A is outer function. And moreover, we notice that this equality also holds almost everywhere on T. This follows from the fact that modulus F squared is just Poisson integral. So it's real part of F, and the calculation by standard shows that modulus F squared is just the same as modulus H squared, 1 minus B modulus squared. And we note also that in this case, our function B that here appears in this representation has is actually a non-extreme function from the unit ball in H infinity, which means that log 1 minus modulus F is L1 of T, which follows from the fact that A is an outer function, which is, means also that log modulus A is integrable over unit disk. So when we start with function F from of unit norm, even not necessarily from unit norm, this function can be represented in such a form. And and on the other hand, we can start with a non-extreme function for the unit ball in H infinity and take then an outer function A such that modulus A squared plus B squared is one almost everywhere on T. So outer function is determined by this property. And then in such a case, we say that the functions BA form a pair. And because B is from the unit ball of H infinity, 1 plus B over 1 minus B is a function of with positive real part for C in B. So this means that can be represented by this Herplot formula. And however, there is a difference. In the first representation, instead of d nu, which is positive finite measure, we had the modulus f of modulus f squared. However, here not necessarily mu must be function. Actually, similar calculation taking real part and so on shows that in this case, this Radon-Nikodym derivative of absolutely component of mu is equal to modulus A 1 minus B squared. In the case mu is absolutely continuous, so here mu is just this expression can be replaced. The pair is called special. Okay. Of course, when we start with an outer function f and form the associated pair BA constructed below, then this pair is special. Okay, maybe before I cite Hayashi results, I mentioned also one of Donald Sarason's result, who showed that if F is an outer function of unit norm and BA is a pair associated with F, then multiplication by F is an isometry on Ki if and only if I is an inner function, however, vanishing at zero, if and only if I divides B. Consequently, if our function in Hitt's theorem is outer of unit norm that acts as an isometry on Ki, then our function F must be of this form. Okay, we remark that although pair BA associated with an outer function is always special, in this, however, the pair B not A need not be special. Some examples are known, can be found in, for example, the Sarason's papers on Toeplitz operators. Okay. Oh, sorry. Oh, now I can state higher. Now I state Hayashi's theorem under the above notation. The merely a star invariant subspace of the form F is equal to F Ki is the kernel of Toeplitz operator if and only if F is of this form, F is outer function, which not always the case in general theorem, F is outer function of this form, and the pair B not A is special and F not squared, which is A over 1 minus B not squared, is a rigid function. What in it's important that in 1994 Sarason gave another proof of Hayashi's theorem, and his proof was based on the Branges-Rovnyak spaces theory. Here I have a definition, the definition of these spaces, but I think I can skip it. I'll just say that the Branges-Rovnyak space is the image of H2 under the operator 1 minus TBT bar square root. B is from the unit ball of H infinity. And this space has the Hilbert space structure, the called range structure defined as follow here. So we have image one, image function G is the same as inner product in H2 for FG from the kernel, from the space orthogonal to the kernel operator. As mentioned many times in previous lecture, H of B is a Hilbert space with the reproducing kernel KWB of Z1 minus B of W conjugated B of Z1 minus bar WZ. Okay, if B is inner, then of course H of B is the well known model space KB is orthogonal complement of BH2. In the rest of my lecture, I will always assume that B is an extreme point of the unit ball, and I will be interested mainly in such a case of the Branges-Rovnyak spaces, H of B, with B non-extreme function for short. So as we mentioned, in this case, if I have a non-extreme function, which means non-extreme point of the unit ball function that is a non-extreme point to satisfy this condition, then I can construct always a function A such that on the unit circle we have this equality and get a pair. And here is some relation between let me mention some relation between this H of B, Rovnyak, the branch spaces, and the space which is M of A, which is just the image under this Toeplitz operator with symbol A, so multiplication actually equipped with the range norm. This space is contained contractively in H of B always. And moreover, if BA is the pair associated with an outer function F, then M of A is dense in H of B, even only if F squared is a rigid function. So we have such a condition when inclusion proper, is a proper M of A can be proper subspace or when it's dense in H of B. Okay, and one more remark, I go back to kernels. We know that the kernels are R-star invariant subspaces, and I have such a subspace of the form F times KI, and this is the kernel of Toeplitz operator, then it is exactly the kernel of T with symbol I bar F bar over F. And while reading books, Masreji and Hicken, which is most of cited results can be found in these books, two volume books, I found such a remark that it was noticed that in the case when I have an outer function of unit norm of this form, A over 1 minus B, so B is non-extreme, A, BA is a pair and so on, and I is an inner function, permission at the origin that divides B, so I have here, instead of B, actually I, B not, then FKI KI is a subspace of kernel, which is, this kernel is I bar F bar over F, and according to Hayashi's theorem, the equality holds if and only if the pair B not A is special and F not squared is rigid. So we ask, what complement of kernel, what complement of FKI in the kernel of this Toeplitz operator can be. And actually, following the proof, the Sarasson proof of Hayashi's theorem, and using very important the operator T1 minus B, TF bar, which is an isometry in this case of H2 onto HB, we proved the following theorem. So we assume that we have a pair, I B naught, where I is inner, vanishing at zero. And this is a pair associated with an outer function F. If the pair B naught A is not special, or the function F naught squared is not rigid, then we have such a relation that the image of this complement FKI in the kernel of T I bar F bar over A over F is equal to I and complement of M closure of M of A in HB naught. So we started to look what we know, what can be said first about such a complement in the case when B naught is what this space consists of. And what maybe let me say what it's known. Actually, sufficient and necessary condition for for the space H0 of B to have finite dimension was given by Donald Sarason, can be found in his book and also in Masredji book. However, this condition does not specify elements of this space. And let me say also that some few years ago, some results on complement of M of A in the space H of B for rational pairs were obtained. First, I think this result was got by Costara and Ransford in 2013, next by Fricken and Hartman and Ross in 2016. Also, my student, former student Wanucha, and me, we got similar some overlapping of results in this paper by Fricken, Hartman and Ross. Okay. So now I cite the result of Sarason that can be found in Sephardic Hilbert spaces in the unit disk and Fricken-Masredji book. And one of this characterization, but not only one, there are some other equivalent condition for this fact that the co-dimension of closure of M of A in H of B is N. So turns out the co-dimension, M of A closure in H of B is N if the operator, I didn't specify here why. It's written here. Y is the restriction of the shift operator S to H of B. So if the Y star adjoint has eigenvalues Z1 bar, Z2 bar, Zs bar on the unit circle with the algebraic multiplicities N1 and so on and S such that N is the sum of this N. And what is important that the space H naught of B is then the space that is spanned by the root spaces of the operator Y star. That is, we have H naught of B, which is a complement of M of A closure in H of B, can be written in this way. So this kernel y star minus zj bar power n j. Okay, so if you would like to find explicit formulas for functions from this space, we are supposed to find these kernels. Or these root spaces. And so, because it is easier case, I try to describe one-dimensional subspaces, one-dimensional spaces, H naught of B. And to describe them, I need the notion of the angular derivative and the derivative in the sense of Parato-Dori. Sorry, I forgot. Here is equivalent conditions. So derivative f prime has a non-tangential limit at z naught. Z naught is a point from the boundary of the unit disk, and which is equivalent to that if this derivative has not tangential limit at z naught, then also f has non-tangential limit at z naught, say at z naught, and this quotient has non-tangential limit. When in the case we have function v, which is from analytic from d into d, we can say that b has an angular derivative in the sense of Parra-Theodori at z naught if B has an angular derivative at z naught and modulus B of z naught is 1. And in books, many properties can be found. In the case, many properties of functions of H of B, generally speaking, when B is non-extreme function and B has an angular derivative in the sense of Parra-Theodori at the point z naught from the unit circle. These conditions, for example, are equivalent. I think it was mentioned by Dan Timokin today that in such a case, K z naught B can be defined and is a function in the space H of B. Moreover, we have formula, so it's a kind of kernels function also for value, for calculating value f of z naught. And to go further, I need also a slight kind of generalization of what I said before. I need the so-called Clark measure. So instead, for lambda from the unit circle, I can consider also function with a real part, 1 plus lambda bar b, 1 minus lambda b bar, lambda bar b, and consider corresponding function f lambda, which is of this form, 1 minus lambda bar b, which is actually random Nicodym derivative of the absolutely components of mu lambda modulus squared. Modulus f lambda squared is absolute continuous. And also was noted by Sarason that almost every lambda in the circle, mu lambda is absolutely continuous. So it's, and again, the following equivalence following statements are equivalent. M of A is dense in H of B. There is lambda such that mu lambda is absolutely continuous and f lambda squared is rigid. Mu lambda is absolutely continuous and f lambda squared is rigid for every. Okay, in the proof of our result, I also use the following result, I think due to Sarason. So let z naught be a point of t and lambda be also a point of t, and such that mu lambda is absolutely continuous. So we know that can happen. And the following equivalent, z naught bar, which is important, is an eigenvalue of y star. The function f lambda of z over 1 minus z bar z is in H2, and the function b has an angular derivative in the sense of Parra-Theodori at z naught. And what actually we proved that under this assumption, so say that mu lambda is absolutely continuous and b has an angular derivative at z naught, then z naught is an eigenvalue of y star. Then the kernel is one dimensional, of course, and is spanned by function, by this function k z naught b. This actually means that this function k z naught b, actually we have already known that it is in the space H of B, but this theorem shows that this function is actually in the orthogonal complement of M of A in H of B. Actually, every one-dimensional space H naught B is always of this form. A few words about proof. Okay, I have still time. So I can say a few words about the proof. In the proof, we use also a kind of operator, a capital A lambda on H2, introduced by Sarason. And also, this is formula for this operator. And if A lambda is defined as it's written here, then we also know that under our assumption that mu lambda is absolutely continuous, the operator 1 minus lambda bar b t f bar f lambda is isometric of h2 onto hb. And this operator intertwines A lambda with the operator Y star adjoint Y. And in this case, it turned out that it was easy to calculate, to find the space of this kernel. Kernel A lambda minus Z naught bar. And this space is spent, this kernel A lambda minus Z naught bar is spent by this function. And then one can quite easily check that the kernel Y star minus Z naught bar is spent by H, which is the image of this function G, which is from kernel of this operator A lambda minus C naught bar, and we found the explicit formula for this. So it's H is C K Z naught G, where C is given in terms of lambda and B naught and B of Z naught. Okay, so maybe I go back to my first theorem one. I try to do here. So maybe now, at least in the case of one-dimensional this space, I can think what is the actually pre, what is this complement of FKI in the kernel of this T I bar F over F. This actually is pre-image of this space in the case one, in my case in one dimensional case. Okay, so in this, when I have this space, is one dimensional, this also is one dimensional, and actually is this space, kernel T I bar F bar over F minus FKI is the pre-image of I K Z naught B naught under the isometry T minus B T F bar. And actually we were able to find this pre-image. Here is formula. I don't know if it's interesting enough. So now let me go further and tell you about some result in more general case, namely in the case this space H naught of B is finite dimensional. We know all that we have this kernel, reproducing kernel in this space, and this function, which are epsilon VBWN, which is the derivative of this nth derivative of this kernel with respect over bar WN. These functions are actually the kernels for functionals of evaluation of nth derivatives at W, which means that we have such situation that nth derivative of F can be calculated here is with sine B. It's a space in a product in the space H of B. And also we had the following Sarasson theorem, which is in some sense generalization of before cited theorem for n when n is one. And these were conditions given. The following conditions were equivalent conditions. So one of them is that the functions, this function, I called them epsilon and WB, are bounded in the norm as W tends non-tangentially to Z naught. This is equivalent to the fact that each function in H of B has all its derivatives up to order n have non-tangential limits at Z naught. Moreover, I think that also was mentioned by Dan Timotin today, that in this case, we can get another functions which are limit case in some sense. This function B Z naught M of Z, it's a non-tangential limit when W it can be considered as a pointwise limit when W tends non-tangentially to Z naught of these functions. This I call these derivatives. And also this epsilon B Z naught M, one can show that easily that they are also in the space H of B in such a case. However, our main result, which is a slightly more difficult, not slightly, but more tiring, and it's quite hard to prove. And we were able to show actually that in the case this space H naught of B is n-dimensional and operator, so which is it means that operator Y star has eigenvalues on the unit circle, then this space consists of, is spanned by these functions, this bound, in some sense, boundary. I don't know how to say this, not derivative, but some boundary functions in some sense. Zj is from the unit circle in this case. So let me say that this space, my talk, today talks, is based on these papers. One is published already, so they let them. Thank you very much for your attention. I think I finished at the moment. Thank you very much.
Thank you indeed, Maria. Let's thank the speaker. Is there any question or comments for Maria? Apparently not. If not, let's thank her again.
Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you.